Alright, so what we're dealing with here today is going to be dealing with family is bondage. It's basically the topic, and we're breaking down how. We give basically three reasons why, but overall the topic and what you're going to get out of this is why family is bondage, and why and how you need to get free from it. Now, if you look at the origins of the word family, it's going to take you to many words. It's going to be many words. Or you do the etymological background. A family, you deal with the word, you're going to see it means bondage. It's going to take you to dem, D-E-M, but then it's going to take you to D-O-M, dom, or dom. And that's where you get the word dominate or to domesticate. So those words and those concepts dealing with family, without a doubt, origin from the word dom or to control or to dominate over something. And so that's what family is. The institution of family started out as an institution, you can say, in the Neolithic and Paleolithic and Neolithic ages, and it moved on, and it developed even more greatly, let's say, when we started to build villages and cities, and even then empires and kingdoms. And then family became a construct that was very much the backbone and the foundation of a whole civilization. But you gotta understand, it developed around the Neolithic period and the Paleolithic period, with us starting to gather in troops and groups and organizing. So we're dealing with that. We take it all the way from the early primitive age, and you take it all the way to the medieval period. This is where you get the word family from. It goes through the Latin and the Greek cultures, and it eventually ends up amongst the Europeans in Britain in the English language, which is family. And all of these words, all etymology and all of these words in the alphabet come from the Phoenicians or Africans. So this word dome will take you all the way back to the Phoenicians or the Africans, the alphabet would. But in English, these Englishmen in Britain, these Europeans who are in America and Western Europe, in their language, you have to understand where they were at the time during the medieval and Renaissance periods and even the Dark Ages. During that period, they constructed something called the feudal system. Now, the feudal system is basically like a caste system. At the top, you have the kings and the monarchs. Below that, you have the lords. Under that, you have the knights. And below them, you have the peasants and then serfs. So there's about five or four levels or categories. And serfs just means servants. So at the bottom was just the servants and then peasants. So what am I saying? I'm saying family as an institution was developed and cultivated under this feudal system, under this caste system. And the monarch family was the family that dominated all of these other minor isolated families that make up a whole, let's say, kingdom, a whole province, or a whole village, a whole area. So the point I'm making is that the whole concept and the origins of where we get the idea of family from in the West, the family institution, is dealing with a social construct and a concept of putting humans in bondage. Because you have to understand, it's a caste system. So if I'm a lord, like I said, there's monarchs, lords, knights, then peasants, and serfs. So if I'm a lord or a king, but a lord, I would have a manor or an estate. And in my estate, my sons would inherit the property eternally, as long as we dominate, there's the word dominate, that landmass. And the people who are the peasants or serfs who work for me, they will work as what, my servants, if I'm a lord. And the point is, the whole institution of family was to organize these peasants or these families, these peasants or serfs or servants, to be adequate servants to these lords, and then the lords for the kings. So if you were born a serf or a servant or a peasant and went in the feudal system, if you were born or if you gave birth to children, it was because your father needed you to be a servant for himself, or he needed you to be a servant for the king or for the lord. So you were born literally a slave, but it wasn't technically the slavery we're thinking of in America with the transatlantic slave trade. It's a different type of slave, but at the end of the day, it's pretty much the same. The only difference is the atrocity of kidnapping a human being and stripping them of their culture, their history, their identity, and their freedom, or all their freedoms. So you see what I'm saying? But you have the same basic not as complex as that type of slavery, the same basic slavery as indentured servitude, where you're perpetually trapped without being able to get on a higher level of this caste system or this feudal system. Unless you marry in, but that's very rare, that you can marry in and rank up. So the point is, you're perpetually, from generation to generation, trapped as basically the person who does all of the labor and all of the worst work in that village or in that that manor or in that land. So that's what family is. It's a way to produce children, produce slaves or servants. That's what family means. It means those who are domesticated. Domesticated. So just like how we know that we domesticated cattle, like cows, sheep, dogs, cats, we domesticated and we use these animals for our utility, or we manipulate them to do what we need them to do. That's what we call domesticating animals. What I'm saying is, family is the domestication of humans. It's the same thing. So if I'm going to domesticate a bunch of sheep, what I do? I need to get me a sheepfold. I need to get me some land, get me some fences. That's the boundaries, that's the culture. I need to get feed for them to be able to eat from day to day. So that's the grass or whatever they may eat. So basically the sheep, they're born in captivity and being domesticated. They're born in domestication. Basically, they're slaves and they have no idea, because the shepherd or the owner of the sheep basically gave birth to them under a construct that that's what they are and that's what they always should be. But the family construct of this metaphor or this parallel with the sheep is that the sheep will not try to escape out of the pen. They will never try to escape out of the pen. Why? Because they're going to all follow the same fold. They're going to follow each other socially. They're very social creatures. So what I'm saying is, most mammals are social creatures. So we domesticate mammals. So that's sheep, cows, dogs, cats, so on, because they're very much dependent on social gratification. So my point is, the same idea that we have in our mind of domesticating animals, and we say that's okay, there's nothing wrong with that. What I'm saying is it okay to domesticate a human, to make humans as pets? Well, that's all that children are. And that's all that a group of family members are inside of a family. Because every family has a patriarch or a leader over the family. And so, like I said, in Britain, in the medieval period, Renaissance period, and even today, that patriarch or that leader over the family, that elder who is basically over everybody, everybody is his slave. He can sell his daughters if he wants to. He can sell his sons to this merchant or to, you know, he has all of the power and all of the profit over their labor and over their life, all control. And it's under a construct that the king decides, which is based on a monarchy. So what I'm saying is basically that the same way we domesticate animals is the same way that we are domesticated in families. It's the same thing. So with saying that, I'm gonna break this down and move on from that point. But basically what I'm trying to say is that family is bondage. And I'm going to show you how. I'm going to give you a metaphor and you'll be able to understand it as we go through. But if family is bondage, then who's the master? The master is nature. Now I say nature, I mean the physical world, the physical or the material illusory world, this physical world. That's the master, nature. Now if you go into mythology, especially the Gnostic mythology, they have the demiurge. Amongst the Hindus, his name is Indra. Amongst the Greeks, they call him Zeus. So in all of these spiritual systems, half of society, or the lower class of society, made a philosophical attempt to renounce and defy the demiurge, or this principal king, deity that rules over all life forms, all life in this material world. So what I'm saying is, the master is the demiurge. That's the male. The male master. The master's wife is nature. The slave catchers, now who would be the slave catchers? The slave catchers are your parents. They're your parents. The plantation is the physical world. This whole physical world is the plantation. The overseers are your genes. Your genes. Your, basically, I'm going to translate to the archons. Now, if you study the archons, that's in Gnosticism again. But in the Greek mythology, they're called the Olympians. In the Hebrew mythology, they're called the Baalim. In the, let's say, the Hindu, they're called the Devas, or the Gandharvas, Apsaras, Devas have many names. The have many names, but those are basically your genes, and your cells on a microscopic level within your body that control your what biology, your hormones, your breathing, everything, all of your whole system, your nervous system, respiratory system, all of it. That's your genes. Basically, that's the archons. So those are the overseers. From day to day, they make sure you stay enslaved. The labor, why are you laboring? What is the labor from day to day? The labor, the whole job, the crops that you're cultivating is to feed the ancestors. Now, the ancestors are a little bit lower than the archons, but they're trapped as well. But you understand with the ancestors is that they're very much hungry. So they needed you. The reason why they made your parents have that sexual urge or that sexual desire, which they're nothing but genes and hormones, that's what the ancestors are. The reason why they gave that to your parents is because they themselves need food to process, to break down and create new cells and generate new cells to build their genes. You see, to build your genes. So that's basically why you were born. That's what nature does. It's a trick. Everything that we're doing, that you doing as a human in your biology, is a trick from nature. So the labor, like I said, that you do from day to day, from every breath, every heartbeat, everything, the crops that you're picking, is nothing but to feed the ancestors, to feed yourselves. So we enslaved by ourselves. We enslaved by our genes. We don't know it because we can't talk to them, but they're very desperate to survive and to perpetuate themselves. And all you is a human is basically the tool or the car or the vehicle for them to do it. So you don't have your own liberty. You have to take control of your body and your genes. And we'll deal with that in a minute, but that's how you get free. But anyway, the chain. What is the chain? So I told you family is bondage. So what is the chain? The chain is family itself. That's the chain that's got you locked to this material world, to this physical world. That's the chain. And when we say family, we mean each one of your family members is a different link or a different part of the chain. Check. The link or the lock of the chain is the bonding hormone. It's the bonding hormone. Now this hormone basically is a hormone that travels through our synapses and through our nervous system, through our it's a neurotransmitter that moves throughout our brain that basically gives us the satisfaction of being socially accepted or socially validated when we bond with what we call family, friends, and society. But it's really an illusion. It's really a trick. It's a hormone. If anybody's born and they have a dysfunction of that hormone, they can't comprehend what you call bonding or love or whatever. So what does that show you? That it's not really going on. It's really an inner illusion going on. You see, and we'll go deep into the psychology and what all of this is. But right now I'm trying to make it simple with just dealing with this topic. But I can go into the inner worlds and how all of this is controlling you and dominating you. But the link itself to the chain or the lock is the bonding hormone. Okay, so what are the shackles? The shackles of this bondage is the shackles is your ego and your attachments. You see what I'm saying? Your ego and your attachments. Meaning the whole idea that you're a human, that you're a race, that you're this, your name that you were born, that you were given, that's your shackles. And your attachments, the ideas that you fantasize with, that you attach with, that you desire, your ambitions, your desires, your motivations, your dreams. Those are what the two shackles that trap you into this bondage. And family is the very engine that gave you all of those, gave you those shackles, gave you your ego and gave you your attachments. They're the ones who groomed you for it and gave you the ideas, put the ideas in your head. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to show you how to break these shackles or show you that you're wearing shackles. That's the ego and your attachments. So you have to practice detachment and crush your ego. And you know how you do that through spiritual practices. And I can document that and how to do that, but I'm just laying it down. What has us in bondage? What has you in bondage? Now the whips. What is the whips? What is the whip that the slave master uses? The whips are the family values. So, like I said, what is the whips? The whips is the family values. That's the whip. The beatings. Now every day, you know, when a slave tries to get free or tries to show any level of rebellion, what do? They get beat. So what you have to understand, like I said, family is bondage. The beatings is every season, every seasonal holiday, and every seasonal festival. Those are the beatings. That's you getting whipped back into the plantation. Now, the beatings, when the actual whip hits your back, the beatings, like I said, is the holidays, the dinners, and the cookouts. Now, all the holidays really are nothing but narcissist parties, okay? They're basically where you get together in a social dynamic with narcissists, and usually there's a head narcissist, either the matriarch or patriarch, who basically is abusive and abusing all the people there, and they all in competition or all in some type of narcissist party. A party of what? Narcissism. That's all it is. That's what these holidays, dinners, and cookouts are. Okay, so what is the conditioning? Because remember, every slave that's to remain a slave has to be conditioned. If you want your slave to be a slave forever, you have to condition it. But that conditioning is the fake love or the conditional love. Now, you have to understand, if you're not open-minded to understand this now, maybe in the future you will, but you remember you heard that I said this, that pretty much on a bottom basic human level, your family does not really have genuine love or unconditional love for you. And if you be honest with yourself, do you really have unconditional love for them? And what I mean is the social construct of family, just like a pack of wolves or a pride of lions, or any type of mammals that have a social group, is based on respect and is based on honor. The moment that you lose respect, or the moment that they feel that they are better than you, this competition or this condescending or this resentful attitude, you have to understand that all the love that they've shown is based on conditions, and it's all fake love. So what is the conditions? The conditions are different variables. It's whether or not you are doing better than them or less than them. That's basically how you're being treated. It's an arrangement, a social arrangement of different levels of treatment based on your status. So in the animal kingdom, dealing with a pack of wolves, and let's say a pride of lions, you have alphas, betas, sigmas. You have these different levels of the social ladder. So a family is nothing but a small nucleus of that same system that is on a larger scale in society. So the point I'm trying to make is that all the love that you see in with family is bondage, because it's conditioning, it's a delusion or deception, because what it really is conditional love to manage and keep this social positioning. The conditioning is fake love, which is basically social positioning. That's all the family and society is social positioning. It's trying to see where your ego fits on a level of success or the level of failure or the level of admiration or the level of lack of admiration, the level of respect or the level of lack of respect. That's all that family is. So once you break that spell, you understand that there is no genuine love that can be shown between humans that are organized. It's always an insincere, shallow circumstance or backgrounds of what's really going on when humans gather. So with that, let me move on to the next point. Okay, so what is the bondage overall? What is this bondage? It's ignorance. Now, you have many people that would say that the society is what needs to be exposed. Society is what's taking away our freedom. The government is what's taking away our freedom. Racism is taking... But what you have to understand is all of them depend on the family. All of them depend on the family, period. So any level that you're saying is bondage or keeping you enslaved, it all starts with your family. So if you say that we're in the Matrix, well, what is the Matrix? The Matrix is family. You say that we're trapped in Maya, what is Maya? Maya's family. So Stockholm Syndrome, what's that? The Stockholm Syndrome is bonding. So that bonding that you have is the Stockholm Syndrome with the family. The revolution or rebellion, that revolution or rebellion against slavery is you just simply seeking the truth. Once you start seeking the truth, you'll start to destroy all of the different lies and traditions that keep the family foundation alive. And it don't matter if you're coming from a Christian background, Islamic background, Hindu background, any background, society and family is built on lies and deception. Like I said, which is based on these hormones that take over the function of the biology of the body that perpetuate the illusion of nature. Because remember, nature's tactics is deception. First is deception, brutality, and sexuality. That's what nature moves by. So the same way a butterfly will lie to you, by camouflaging itself as an owl, or a chameleon will lie to you by hiding itself as a leaf or a bush, or a snake will lie to you and camouflage itself as a tree or something else. The same way that these animals will lie to you, that mechanic is coming from nature, not from the animal itself. It's a tool from nature. Well, that's the same thing that your family are doing right in front of you from day to day. They are innately, subconsciously, not intentionally, deceiving you. And that is basically what you need to revolt or lift the rebellion against. And anybody that seeks truth in any family, whether it be modern or ancient, Eastern or Western, American or not American, Christian or Islamic, it doesn't matter. You study all ancient masters, when they began to seek the truth, they had to what? Renounce their family. That was the very first 2 to 3 steps of them being able to get spiritual liberation. And why? Because the family is the construct of Maya. It is the construct of this illusion. It's like we know that the world is a stage and everybody's wearing a mask. Well, what keeps that stage together? What keeps that play intact? It's the family. So when you so the revolution, the rebellion, is seeking the truth. As simple as that. When we dealt with the demiurge, that's just basically seeking gnosis. You're able to break through his whole illusion, but that's seeking the truth. And you seek it where within. Your family, they're going to dissuade you from the truth. Because remember, they're trapped by these beatings. They're trapped by these chains. They're trapped by all of these things that are in the plantation. You see, that the demiurge or nature, or which would be the higher class of society, is using to trap them and keep them in bondage and you in bondage. So they do it through what peer pressure and influence. But they don't know they don't know that they themselves are under this conditioning or programming. So they'll try to put you under it. So you'll waste your whole life trapped in mundane things and never able to find what the truth. So how do you lift the rebellion or revolution one more time? It's seeking the truth. It's that simple. And we know the cliche. Once you start seeking the truth, you basically make yourself an enemy against the whole family. Family don't want to deal with you. Or the family what resents you. Well, this is why. Now, the slave running away, the slave getting what freedom, is knowledge and renunciation. Renunciation means renouncing the world. The family is the world. The whole world, just like in the New Testament with this Yeshua, this Christ figure, or Jesus, as the West calls him, like he said, renounce the world. The world is what? Of the devil, of Satan. Well, that's talking about the demiurge. You see? That the world is a place that's not of God. You know, all of these different things of being anti the world. Well, what I'm trying to tell you is the world is family. Family and the world is one and the same. You can't have one without the other. So, the slave running away is gnosis or knowledge, which we're dealing with right now. And renunciation. Renunciation may be a new word, but it basically just means renouncing the world, abandoning or rejecting the world. And how you do that practically? Well, just subscribe and I'll be breaking that down in the future, but I'm showing you why you should do it and then I'll show you how. But the point now that I want to make is that there's a lot of people in the Black community, especially now in the West, even the white community and all of these other diverse Americans, where we have in broken homes. And what you have to understand what's significant about this is a broken family or a broken home, the children will either be holy or demonic, but they will not be normal. See, most families that produce children, they have normal slaves, normal children, people who just go on with the status quo. But in a broken family, you what? Break the bondage. In a broken family, it's the opportunity to what? Break the bondage. All of the delusion that comes from these things come from father, mother, grandfather, grandmother, uncle, aunt, cousins, brother, sister. So when it's a broken family, pieces of the illusion are removed from your world and you're able to pierce into a bigger aspect of reality where you're not conditioned by one of the parts of reality by your parents. Because you have to understand the masculine and feminine aspect of this reality or society to be a productive member of society, to function with the society, because the father's going to give you some secrets and some jewels about how to navigate and behave, and the mother's going to give you some secrets or some jewels from both sides of the reality. And you got to understand, both sides of the reality are competing and at odds with each other and are enemies, but it's a secret. So being a child, being born in this conflict that's in society, you yourself can survive and manage despite the conflict of the two opposing energies that are really fake themselves or wearing a mask and deluding each other as well. But a child is groomed on how to navigate through that. But once you have a broken home, broken family, most likely the father gone, but a lot of times it's the mother too, you have the opportunity for that knowledge or for that rebellion or for the opportunity to run away, to escape, because one of your shackles is gone. So it could be a negative circumstance. It could be the worst thing that could happen to a community or people or to a person. But it could be the best thing, you see? So you have to understand, put things from a different perspective. Look at things from a different perspective. You being born in a broken family, for those who are, single parent home, so on and so forth, you could be potentially the person that's able to break the bondage of this material world. And you have to understand, all of your Christ figures, heroes of the Greek mythology, Phoenician mythology, Hindu mythology, Hebrew mythology, or Hebrew folklore, all these different cultures, even in the comic books, even in the movies. You gotta check out The Hero's Journey by Joseph Campbell, study Carl Jung. But the heroes or the Christ figures, they always come from a broken home, a broken family. The issue is, the problem is also that's where villains come from. So they can either be holy, they can be exceptional and become holy, men or women, holy men or women, that's basically like ascetics or renunciates, basically like monks, but they'd be basically spiritual. Or they're either going to be that, if they're not able to overcome these principles, they're going to become demonic. But if they're able to overcome these principles and defeat the slave master, which is basically the demiurge or nature, their own nature and nature, if they're able to defeat it, they are the holy. If they're not, they're the demonic. But it's an opportunity for them either way. And what is the cause of this whole bondage? What started all of this bondage at the beginning? Well, the cause of this bondage is ancestral karma. So like I said earlier, the labor is to feed the ancestors. That's basically why we're enslaved, is to feed them. Now, why are we in bondage to feed them if they're in a whole nother world or in the spiritual world or inside of our body? Why do we have to be in bondage to them? Because you have to understand that you yourself, your soul, was at one point inside of them, and you put them in bondage. So at some point, somebody has to bring this karma or dharma, which means practicing dharma, bring that dharma to an end, that karma to an end. So your life can be an opportunity to free your ancestors from their enslavement, from these lower regions, and lift them to the crown and get them what? Liberated. But until you do that, and unless you do that, you yourself will be trapped having to feed them. All that you are as a human is half of your mother's chromosomes or half of your mother's genes and half of your father's genes. That's all you are. So basically with that, that is the cause of this whole bondage. It's basically ancestral karma, you see. Like I said, they are the genes inside of you that were once in a human body at one point, and you were a spark or a soul inside of their body. And you were that ancestor. And this is African spirituality. It's called lineal reincarnation. The people of Ifa or Vodun, they call it Ababatunde or Yetunde or Atunwe, which means to reincarnate, meaning your ancestors reincarnating. So the point is, what I'm saying is, at one point they were in bondage to this physical world, and now they're inside of you, but they have to eat to survive. And you can do two things, like I said, to take the holy path and lift them up and free them, or become demonic and torment them. There's three different type of people that will watch this. There's the holy, the good, and then there's the evil. For the holy, renounce the world. Like I said, that's your rebellion, that's your revolution. Run away, renounce it. Renounce the whole world, and that's how you get free from bondage. Renounce family completely. And it'll be very easy for you to renounce family because you might not have none. See, so renounce it. And that's who these heroes usually are. Like I said, they're orphans, or their parents, one of their parents died, or one of their parents abused them, or they don't have no family or parents. Those are usually the heroes or the Christ figures and so on. So what I'm saying is, for the holy, renounce family and the world completely. But for the good, take care of your ancestors, feed your ancestors. That's how you're able to manage and keep reality going. Because you may already have children. That's the reality for most people are probably watching this. So if you have children, you have to maintain feeding your ancestors and practicing devotion and trying to get your ancestors back to the heavenly planes that we all once were before they fell. By their fall, you fell. So you basically have to manage from day to day for the rest of your life, feeding them with the hopes of an opportunity or window opening for you to get free from this bondage. Like I said, which is nothing but family. But for the evil, basically you're going to buck against the ancestors and they're going to put you deeper into slavery. That's all that's going to happen. The demiurge, the archons, and the ancestors, they're going to put you nothing but in deeper slavery. And that will basically, what that will look like is just continual misfortune from generation to generation. And I can break down the specifics of this in the future because I know most people are thinking, well, what if you don't have children? Well, I'll deal with that in the future. But so the three reasons to summarize all of this and bring this to an end, like I said, the reasons why family is bondage is one, the word and the etymological origins of the word family literally comes from bondage or servant or slave or so on. Two, the second reason is physical bondage. That's what I went through when I said that society and the feudal system in Europe used family as an institution to create slaves for the monarchy and for these lords. And a father can give birth to a bunch of children to enslave them for himself, just like animals. Because like I said, that is the domestication of humans. So that's the second point was physical bondage. The third is spiritual bondage. Family is literally what spiritual bondage. With those three points, that should bring it to a conclusion, like I said, and make the points to let you know that family is bondage. Okay, this is out of the Upanishads. Bondage is the thought of I, mine, father, mother, brother, house, or land. Okay, it says the holy man or ascetic is free of the activity of family. Okay, it says the holy man or the ascetic must renounce friends and family. To attain moksha, which is liberation of the soul, it is necessary for a man to shun attachment first of all. Only after that, he will become free from sorrows. When he becomes free from sorrow, he unites with the Supreme Almighty. This phenomenon is known as yoga, yoking yourself to God. Unification with the Supreme Almighty enables a man to attain knowledge and finally moksha, or salvation. It is therefore essential for all those seeking salvation that, first of all, they should renounce affection and attachment for worldly objects, including their near and dear ones.